What's going on, man? Welcome back to the basement. I'm Ron, and I want to thank you guys for all the love that you guys have been showing the videos recently. We just hit like 2.3k subscribers. We literally just hit 2,000 subscribers last week. This has easily been the craziest growth I've ever seen on YouTube, so I want to thank you guys for that. And part of this growth has been my zero RB video. You guys loved it. That's at like 4,000 views now, which is insane. I usually get like 700 on a normal video, but you guys really liked the zero RB strategy video. And the funny part is that zero RB is not even my favorite strategy in 2021, or do I even think it's the best strategy in 2021. My actual number one draft strategy is hero RB. This is going to be where we take one RB early and we just kind of punt off the rest of the running backs, and we just punt RB2 and wait until we get one late. So it's kind of like a modified zero RB approach. Still has a lot of the same principles. I know some people call it hero RB, anchor RB, modified zero RB, whatever. We're going to call it hero RB for the sake of this video so no one gets confused. Let's not waste any more time. Make sure you subscribe, leave a like. Let's get into the number one draft strategy in 2021, in my opinion. Let's go.
Shout out my mucus. Can you know that be my slime? Shout out my mucus.
So let's kind of break down what hero RB even is. It's pretty much how it sounds. You take one running back in the first three rounds and you assume this is going to be your hero running back. You know, you draft Austin Eckler. He comes with a cape and everything, Superman on his chest. He is your hero running back. You assume that that guy is a dog. Then you wait on RB2 and you don't take one until round six. Now, the whole question is, why would we do this? Why would we take one early? Why would we wait for the other one late in the draft? And the whole idea is that we want exposure to these early round running backs. Early round running backs that hit, that offer that huge upside, actually have the biggest edge in all of fantasy football. And we define these running backs, you know, the ones that have this crazy upside, as legendary upside running backs. These are the running backs that can have seasons named after them, like Christian McCaffrey in 2018, 2019. Your league's taco could have drafted Todd Gurley in 2017 and still won it all. We want exposure to that. The phrase was coined by Pat Corain. That's going to be his article on early round upside running backs, is going to be what we refer to with all of these graphs. And he defines legendary upside as a player who can hit a 20% win rate. Now, win rate just means how many times is this player winning your league? 20% win rate means one in five people that drafted this player won their league. And we only have 10 players to ever hit a 20% or better win rate since 2015. We have running backs with seven finishes of 20% and above, and we have wide receivers with just three. And running backs have four finishes with 25% or more win rates. Wide receivers have none. So we want to take a swing on one of these running backs because they offer an edge that no other position can replicate. Now, the common misconception is that every running back has this legendary upside. We want to take a swing on one of these legendary running backs early because, like I said, it offers us this massive upside that you can't get exposure to anywhere else. But the problem is that these swings need to be home runs. The common misconception is that like any running back can be a legendary running back. A guy like Derrick Henry, for instance. Last year, Derrick Henry was sick. 2,000 rushing yards, I think like 17 or more touchdowns. He was crazy. One of the most legendary seasons of all time from a pure rushing standpoint. But from a fantasy standpoint, he didn't hit that legendary upside. I don't think he offers that legendary upside. He hit the nuts last year. He's not going to be a guy that hits a 20% win rate ever. Last year, he had the best case scenario. He still only hit a 15.2% win rate, which is strong, but it's not legendary. Now, you guys might say, you know, that's really strong. Why aren't we aiming for that? The thing is that the wide receivers we can grab in that exact range in round one can replicate that win rate while also busting much less often. Now, as you can see by this chart, wide receivers are more often league winners. So having a 13% or better win rate, Derrick Henry, again, he fits into this category where he had a 15.2% win rate. If we're shooting for 13% or better, which is still like a league winning season, really good, wide receivers are actually edging out running backs in the first three rounds. Actually, now that I look at the chart, though, the first six rounds, wide receivers edge out the running backs in that category. Now, if we look at this graph, they're not only hitting at such a high rate compared to the running backs are busting at a way higher rate than the wide receivers through the first three rounds. So the only reason that you should be taking a running back over wide receiver, again, wide receivers are winning leagues at a higher rate and they're busting lower. The only edge that you can get is that legendary upside from a running back. So the only reason to go running back over wide receiver early is to swing on a legendary upside running back. But because of these bust rates, we don't want to bust our whole team trying to find this legendary upside running back. We don't want to go running back, running back, running back. Because of the bust rates, most of the time, two out of the three of those guys are going to bust. So what we do is we draft one running back in that range to expose ourselves to that legendary upside without busting our entire team trying to find that lottery ticket. Now, the interesting part is if you look at the bust rate chart one more time, we can also see that running backs are busting at a higher rate than wide receivers in rounds 1 and 3, but they're actually about even in round 2. So this gives us an opportunity to kind of do a backwards anchor RB approach. So instead of going with our hero RB in round 1, we can actually go wide receiver in round 1, get an elite wide receiver, and then come around in the second round, and then we can take a swing on our running back, because it seems like wide receivers in round 2 are busting at the same rate as running backs. So you can lock in that safety in round 1 with the wide receiver, then you can come around the back in round 2, take your swing on a legendary upside running back at about the same cost in terms of bust, then you can go into round 3, grab a wide receiver, and then you have a very stable team while also being exposed to league-winning type upside. This gives us zero RB components where we're only taking one running back in the first 3 rounds, and then we're also hammering wide receivers after that, after round 3, 4, 5, 6. We want to hammer wide receivers because we want to be avoiding the RB dead zone. And the RB dead zone is why this strategy is so great, because if you just take one running back in the first 2 rounds, you can sidestep the RB dead zone and you can hammer wide receivers in this spot. And a lot of people out there, I've done RB dead zone videos, but I'll just go over it again. And this RB dead zone is pretty much where you're going to find subpar running backs that are pumped up by volume and projections, and they look good on spreadsheets in week 1, but they're just bad running backs in good situations. Those are kind of the scenarios we want to run away from. Sure, they might hit from time to time, but we don't want these guaranteed touches guys that are just 2-down plotters. They produce RB2 numbers, and not only do they usually flame out and not produce, but when we're drafting these running backs trying to get RB2 numbers, there's a huge problem there, because I think one of the most replaceable aspects of fantasy football outside of streaming quarterbacks, I think it's actually very easy to stream RB2s. Last year, we had James Robinson, JD McKissick, Nyheim Hines all come off waivers, be fine as RB2s. Also, every single week, there's going to be a running back that goes down, and then there's a guy behind him that becomes a clear start. Now, he might not be a locked and loaded RB2 for technical purposes, but if your flex is loaded with wide receivers like it's going to be in this strategy, your RB2 essentially becomes a flex spot that you can play RB3s in and be just fine. There were times last year where I was starting Jeff Wilson, Jerick McKinnon. You could have started DJ Dallas for one of the weeks that Chris Carson went down. You could have started Jamichael Hasty for a week. Joshua Kelly was a starter for a week. There's a lot of different places where you can go off waivers and you can find the guy that's going to slot in and play behind the starting running back, or at least get some kind of role. The problem is that a lot of the times these running backs, the ones in front of them, they get hurt for a game or two, or maybe 3 games, 4 games. The problem is that the running back who comes in behind them does fine, does well, is very impactful for your fantasy team, but at the season end, fantasy points per game, fantasy point finishes, they don't come up big. So everyone looks at the end of the season fantasy point production, the top 24 guys. None of them are guys you could have taken off waivers, but you can stream them together is what I'm trying to say. When the guy in front of them is down, you can swoop in and you can get a couple weeks from those running backs while also scooping up guys like JD McKissick, Nyheim Hines, James Robinson. You can find a way to fill in your RB2 spot as long as you're super strong everywhere else. Now, the poster boys for the RB dead zone last year was guys like Mark Ingram, Le'Veon Bell, Todd Gurley, Melvin Gordon, and David Johnson. You know, people who took these guys probably had 2 running backs and they wanted to make their running back core robust. The problem is that you're completely losing out. If you're completely losing out because you're not getting that legendary upside we're talking about. You only find that type of upside in the first 3 rounds. When you go into round 4, 5, and 6 and you draft these running backs, it's a death sentence, especially because when we look at last year, guys in this range were Stephon Diggs, Calvin Ridley, DK Metcalf, AJ Brown, Keenan Allen, and the numbers are going to show that it's going to be the same exact thing this year. While your league mates are drafting Myles Gaskin and Mike Davis and Josh Jacobs, you're going to be scooping up this year's Calvin Ridley, DK Metcalf in the form of an Ayuk, a T. Higgins, a Chase Claypool, all of these really high upside young wide receivers that can become studs for your fantasy team. And I'm not just kind of speaking out of my ass here. The numbers do agree with this historically. Here are the win rates. This is an article from Jack Miller about the RB dead zone. Here are the win rates side by side since 2015 of running backs versus wide receivers drafted in rounds 3 through 6. Now, the average win rate is 8.3%. And we can see that we need to be prioritizing wide receivers in this range because they are having a better average win rate than all of these running backs in this exact range. So I know that our common instinct is, oh my God, my running back 2 was, there's a hole there. I need to fill it, whether that's with Todd Gurley, Melvin Gordon, or I guess this year, like Myles Gaskin, Mike Davis. You have to bypass that, just skip out on it and wait until later. Get guys into your flex, QB, tight end, even get some wide receivers on your bench. The numbers say that you can find fine RB2s later on in your drafts. Here's the same chart comparing running backs versus wide receivers in win rate from round 7 through 10 since 2015. So while people think that wide receivers are super deep and they're great late in drafts, you can actually see on this chart that the running backs in this range are delivering better win rates. Now, people always say there's way more wide receivers later. Yeah, because every team is playing three wide receivers. There might be more wide receivers in this range, but doesn't mean that they're better. Just go out there and be one of the guys who drafts the running backs. I never get that argument on Twitter. Everyone's like, oh, but there's so many more wide receivers later. Even if there's less running backs, everyone's drafting wide receiver anyways late, so just grab the running backs. Like, as long as you're not reaching on ADP, it's fine. So with all this in mind, we want to be drafting one running back through three rounds, then we want our RB2 in round seven or later, and then we also want to grab a stable of high upside running backs late, because you want to eventually find the guy that you can put in the RB2 spot that's putting up RB1 numbers. Because then once you have your anchor RB, you have an RB2 that you found off waiver somehow, or you have a James Robinson, you know, something like that, that's where you get a huge, huge advantage. And we can replicate opposing RB production until then by just finding guys off waivers, finding a guy on your bench. You will have a guy emerge that can be a low-end RB2, high-end RB3 eventually. Now, this strategy is going to work in pretty much every format. Ideally, you want a start four wide receiver league, so that's going to be three wide receivers in a flex or two wide receivers in two flex, because in those types of leagues, I'm definitely more willing to go almost with a true hero RB approach, where I only go with a running back early, and then I only take like probably another detour away from wide receiver one more time through eight rounds. So six wide receivers through eight rounds, or in a league where it's only three wide receivers, so two wide receivers in a flex spot, you can go a little less wide receiver heavy. I'd probably be trying to aim for four to five wide receivers through eight rounds, and then maybe get a running back. You can even pair your hero running back with, I'm gonna make a video eventually, but the guys I'm like cool with deviating from the dead zone are guys like Travis Etienne and Javonte Williams. You can even get like an elite tight end, an elite quarterback, something like that. You want to have everything on your lineup be bulletproof besides your RB2. That's the whole idea behind the strategy. So let's see what these actually look like in practice. So I did a couple of mocks, and the first one is going to be just a vanilla mock from the 101. It's going to be a two running back, two wide receiver, and one flex league PPR. And I think QRB, one of my favorite spots to do it out of is the 101, 102, or 103. So you grab McCaffrey, Cook, or Kamara, and then you wait on running back for a while. And once you get CMC, you can just establish the edge that you have at running back over the rest of the league, and then you can just move on to your other positions, because you're going to have to make up ground elsewhere. And my favorite way to do this is right at the turn, Waller or Kittle are always going to be there. So I love to take like a Jefferson, an AJ Brown, a DK Metcalf, a Calvin Ridley, a Keenan Allen, and then pair that with a Darren Waller or George Kittle. And then you have three absolute studs at their positions off the bat. Then in this draft, we enter the dead zone, which is like rounds three through six. And that's when we want to hammer wide receivers in this strategy. And we go with Robert Woods, Tyler Lockett, Robbie Anderson. Now, we then get our first running back too with Chase Edmonds in the seventh round. And you guys are going to say, why would you want Chase Edmonds in RB2? Here's the thing. Does it feel great to start Chase Edmonds as my RB2? No. But it feels great to have Tyler Lockett in the flex. Everyone else's flex is going to be weaker than mine. We're gonna use Lockett. He's going to get us those boom weeks. He's going to win us weeks in the flex. We want that for our team. Because like I said, these running backs are busting at a higher rate. So if we store more value in these wide receivers in the middle rounds, we can score more points. And then we can also be safer in our team. Remember, we want to kind of brace for impact of injuries, players busting. We want to have more firepower than we really need. And we want it stored in the positions that bust less often. Then at the tail end of this draft, we grab Tannehill later. We stack on Boyd, because Boyd in the ninth round is just stupid. I don't know why I might do like a best value picks video. I think on Sleeper, there's a couple of ADPs that don't make sense. Same with Rondale Moore. But yeah, so we go Tannehill, we go Boyd, then we hammer late round running backs. We get Pollard for huge upside off the bench. And then Gus Edwards and Latavius Murray are perfect, you know, RB3 options. You put them in there, they might get you a solid 7-8 points. And if they fall into the end zone, they might give you 12, 13, 14. Now here's another mock I did. I wanted to show a couple different scenarios where I'll do it. And here's this other mock where this is going to be a two wide receiver, two flex league. So we went a little bit more wide receiver heavy out of the eight spot. But I love going Davante Adams as the first wide receiver off the board, because we're seven running backs deep, fellas. We're seven running backs deep. I continue to say this, but the whole idea around fantasy right now needs to be, how the hell are you going to compete with a Christian McCaffrey team? I cannot say it enough. We need to be scared of Christian McCaffrey. This 100% should be a year where a third round reversal should be in play. Christian McCaffrey last year, yes, he was hurt, but in the games that he played, he outdid his best seasons ever. He has the best legendary upside season. You know how I said legendary upside is 20% win rate? he had a 36% win rate. Like I said, your league's taco could have Christian McCaffrey, and one third of the time he's going to win your league. Your whole strategy should be centered around, how am I going to beat the team in my league with Christian McCaffrey? And after those running backs, so CMC, Dalvin Cook, Kamara, Saquon, I think there's a huge fall off in that second tier of running backs. So I'm not going to reach on RB8, especially because I feel like from Nick Chubb through Najee Harris, so when we're looking at this board, from Nick Chubb through Najee Harris, all of those running backs are in the same exact tier for me. But Davante Adams, Tyreek Hill, Stephon Diggs are in a tier of their own when it comes to wide receivers. So I'd rather stack on that depth or stack on that advantage. And then I'll come around in the second round, and then that's when I'll grab my hero running back. Because again, when we cite back to the win rates from earlier, we remember the bust rates. Wide receiver has a huge edge on running back in round one. But in round two, the running back and wide receiver bust rates converge. At that point in time, whether you take a wide receiver or a running back in the second round, your risk of busting is almost negligible between the two positions. So I think if you're going to go anchor running back outside of the first three picks, I think you go Davante Adams, Tyreek Hill, Stephon Diggs, or maybe even Travis Kelce, and then you come around in the second round, and then you grab your hero running back, whoever you want, whether that's Aaron Jones, Eckler, Antonio Gibson, whoever is your flavor. Like I said, we want to miss out on the red zone, on the dead zone running backs. We want to get that depth at wide receiver. We go Davante Adams, we go Terry McLaurin, CeeDee Lamb, Tyler Lockett, T. Higgins. Now you guys might tell me, you can't even start T. Higgins. Why would you burn a six-round pick on a guy that's going to be on your bench? We're not perfect at fantasy football. Some of these wide receivers are going to get hurt. Some of them are going to bust. Go back to 2020. Look at your drafts that you did. If you go through the first six or seven, eight rounds, half of your picks are busting. At the fantasy football draft, your team that you start with and the team you end with are two completely different entities. You're constantly making trades and making waiver wire ads because your team is either getting hurt, falling apart, busting. Everything looks good on day one, but everything just becomes an absolute shit show by midseason. So when we know in rounds three through six that wide receivers are winning more leagues, they're busting less, and they're giving us a huge advantage, I want to stack up that advantage in those rounds where my league mates are getting running backs, are going to bust their teams, and then we're going to brace for impact. When injuries come, when busts come, we're going to have four wide receivers at all times that we can start in the two wide receiver spots, in the two flex spots at all times that are going to crush our opponents. That is the whole idea behind hero RB and zero RB. So then round seven hits. That's when we grab Trey Sermon, who I think has crazy upside. He's actually one of my favorite, like, hero RB, RB2, or even in zero RB, having him as my RB1. I think Trey Sermon has a lot of upside in that offense because the 49ers are going to score a lot of points. And not only that, but they have historically had a lot of fantasy points go to their running back core just as a whole. I think like the second most fantasy points per game the last 2 years, just if you just put in like fantasy, if you just put in like 49ers running back. So if he gets a hold of that role, and I'm not really that scared of Raheem Mostert. I think Trey Sermon could be a league winning type running back. Then we grab Robbie Anderson coming back. He's just a screaming value in the eighth round. I've seen him go like late fifth in actual fantasy football drafts, so I don't know why Robbie goes so late on sleeper. But then we come back around, then we start to fill some holes. We grab Logan Thomas, and this is kind of weird because when I do a zero RB team or a hero RB team, I'm usually trying to stack up everywhere besides RB2 on a hero RB team. The problem is we didn't have a spot to grab an elite tight end. None of the tight ends I liked fall to us, and I wasn't going to reach on one of the early quarterbacks, especially when we're drafting against the sleeper AIs. When Josh Allen goes in like the third and Pat Mahomes goes at the 112, we're not grabbing an early quarterback. So that's when we pivot, we grab best player available, we stack value on our bench, and we went with like a late quarterback, late tight end type approach. We go Logan Thomas, so we do have a lot of Washington football team exposure, which I don't love having running back, wide receiver, and tight end from that team. But just to put kind of a cherry on top, I did end up going Ryan Fitzpatrick late to kind of stack with those two guys. And then I have Trey Lance that hopefully Trey Lance becomes a stud. He breaks out by like week three, week four, and then you can swap him in for Ryan Fitzpatrick. One of my favorite things to do right now, if I miss out on the elite quarterbacks and I don't like the value on the board with Ryan Tannehill or something like that, I'll wait and I'll go Ryan Fitzpatrick, and then I'll pair him with Justin Fields or Trey Lance. And then on top of that, to pair with Trey Sermon, we get kind of a mix of a bunch of different running back archetypes. Remember, we want to mix and match these archetypes. We want to have A.J. Dillon, who's just a huge upside kind of backup running back. Then we have Latavius Murray, who's going to give you stable RB3 weeks, who can also be an absolute, if Alvin Kamara went down, Latavius Murray would be a top 15 running back. Then we have James White, who's just a PPR monster. In a full PPR, James White will give you some really good production in that RB2 spot. And then to top it all off, we go with Damian Williams, who is going to be in that Tariq Cohen type role. And if David Montgomery was to go down, Damian Williams would be an absolute stud in fantasy football. So that's a more traditional way to do it. So I showed you guys a hero running back in the first round, hero running back in the second round. Now, this is probably my favorite variation of hero RB. Now, this is swinging for absolute upside, and that's what I needed to do in this $350 high stakes FFPC draft because it's a tournament. So we're going to be drafting with $350 on the line. You need to win your league, and then not only win your league, you go into a pool of champions from like weeks 14 through 17. And from there on, you're competing with all the best teams across the platform. So this is when I'm swinging for the fences. So I can still get some zero RB components by going Davante Adams, George Kittle up front, but then you can stack on that legendary upside running back with DeAndre Swift. I think DeAndre Swift is one of the last guys that offers legendary type upside. He has the receiving capability. He's a stud prospect, and I don't understand his ADP right now. Just as like a side rant, last year we had Miles Sanders, who had a very similar rookie year to DeAndre Swift. Now, we all know Miles Sanders was a bust last year, but just off of kind of his hype and his ADP and all that, he was a guy that was going at the 1-2 turn. Same thing in DeAndre Swift's rookie year is eerily similar to Miles Sanders' rookie year, and it was eerily similar to Christian McCaffrey's rookie year. I don't see why DeAndre Swift isn't a mid-second to like 1-2 turn guy. That's where he would be for me. But in my rankings, I have ADP into account. So I have him right in a spot where I'll get him pretty often without having to reach on him in round two, round one. But this is my favorite way to go. I'd call it like a hero Swift build. I think he's the last guy that you can have as like your anchor running back that truly has that legendary upside. And then after that, we pounded wide receivers. Again, in these leagues where it's two wide receivers, two flexes, I'm completely fine with going six wide receivers through eight rounds so we can have two stud wide receivers on the bench for injuries, buys, all of that, busts, all of that. Godwin, T. Higgins, Robbie Anderson, Debo Samuel, Will Fuller, stud wide receivers through and through with Davante Adams. Then we just change gears. Then we don't take another wide receiver until round 19. We go Zach Moss, who I love as an RB2. We go Jalen Hurts, pair him up with Joe Burrow. So now we have our two stud quarterbacks. We already have our elite tight end that we got earlier. This is tight end premium, by the way. So George Kittle wasn't a reach in the second round. I actually think it was a value. In tight end premium, if Darren Waller is a 8th round pick and tight end premium, then George Kittle should be an 11th or 12th round pick. So I thought that was great value. We go Nyheim Hines, Darrington Evans, Chuba Hubbard, Giovanni Bernard. So Moss gives us like an ambiguous backfield guy. Nyheim Hines is going to be our PPR monster. We have Darrington Evans, who's just a clear handcuff. Chuba Hubbard, who's a clear handcuff. Giovanni Bernard, another like PPR guy. And then Salvin Ahmed is kind of like an ambiguous backfield guy. You could see him seizing a role over Myles Gaskin. Now, obviously, I drafted this guy in the 18th round. That is not the projected outcome, but it's in his range of outcomes that Salvin Ahmed eventually kind of wrestles it into like a timeshare where it becomes usable. So I love this team. We're going to find ways to fill in our RB2 spots off the bench. Our tight end is stacked, our quarterback stacked, our wide receiver stacked, our RB1 and DeAndre Swift. We are pretty much putting all the pressure of this team on DeAndre Swift, but it's a really clean way to go about anchor RB that's not super traditional. So those are three examples of using the strategy in practice. Now, just to recap, the idea of hero RB is very similar to the principles of zero RB, if you guys saw that video. And that's why I think it's such a strong strategy. And I think it's a better strategy than zero RB because you're getting all the principles, all of the benefits of zero RB while also exposing yourself to the high upside of a legendary running back. You're still fading the dead zone running backs. You're still stacking wide receivers. You're still building advantages across the board besides your running back position. And we're also punting the RB2s because we know those guys are really replaceable. And this strategy is dominant. It shows great win rates across the board since 2015. This chart by Jack Miller shows that. The three teams that he listed as zero or as hero RB teams, where they take one running back in the first two rounds and then they wait on the second running back until after round six, they're beating the average win rate of 8.3%. So one out of 12 is 8.3%. Those teams are beating the average of 8.3% by a lot. So anchor RB has historically been great all the way back to 2015. And I just want to say, hero RB is my favorite strategy. It's also can work in any league. As long as it's at least 0.5 PPR, you'll be fine. Now, that's the video. I also want to say my ranks are heavily geared towards this idea of taking our stabs on running backs early, avoiding the dead zone. So I'll have guys, people are going to think that this is egregious, but I have guys like Mike Davis way back, like in the 80s, because I just don't even want to have those guys on my team. So it prioritizes the idea of running back early, wide receivers in the middle rounds, and then you can get your running backs late. And then I'm even pushing up guys like Gus Edwards, like a Latavius Murray, like a Nyheim Hines, a Tony Pollard, an AJ Dillon, a Zach Moss. I'm pushing those guys up into like the ninth round range, where you are now constructing a team that, aside from my player evaluations, everything is optimized. So when you look at historical data, you are taking players where they should be in terms of cost, in terms of price, in terms of risk, and in terms of upside. I think that my draft guide, the way that I have it, is very unique, and I think that it's going to help us dominate leagues in 2021. So if you're interested in that, I have my top 250 and one quarterback super flex. They're all in my rankings on Patreon, patreon.com/Ron Stewart. It's going to be down below in the description and in the comments. And on top of that, for $5, you get my rankings. Then you also get a one-on-one direct line to me for trade advice, start sit advice. If you're on the clock and you want my help on a pick, all of that is there for $5. I'm telling you, it is the best deal in all of fantasy football. So if you guys have a home league out there that you want to go out there and dominate, take home a chip, make sure you go check that out. Now that's going to be it for today. Make sure you go down below into the comments. Let me know how you guys feel about Hero RB. Have you been doing this strategy? Have you done it in the past? Do you like Hero RB? Do you have a strategy that you really like? Now the other strategy I really like is going to be RBRB, where you go running back in round one and then another one in round two or three. And you literally do not touch running back until like round 12, 13, 14, 15. I'm going to touch on that in a video. I think in probably a week or so, I'm going to do a video where I go over all three of those draft strategies I really like. So if you want to see that, make sure you go down below, leave a like. And yeah, man, as always, you can find me at @RonStewart_ on Twitter. I love you guys. The growth recently has been absolutely insane, man. And all the positive comments, dude, you guys really keep me going. We're grinding out here. I'm trying to get 7 days of video. I'm trying to get 7 videos a week for you guys. And yeah, man, I'm just excited for the football season. I hope that you guys are out there dominating your drafts. We're going to be doing some subscriber leagues in the Discord very soon. So make sure you go join the Discord as well. And that's going to do it for today, man. As always, I'll see you guys in the next one.